Welcome to Screw the Commute, the entrepreneurial podcast dedicated to getting you out of the car and into the money with your host, lifelong entrepreneur and multimillionaire, Tom Antion.
Hey, everybody, it's Tom here with episode 404 of Screw the Commute podcast. I'm here with Burke Allen, and he and I have a West, by God, Virginia connection. You got to say by God anytime you say West Virginia. just a little note there for you folks. He's from there, and he's had lots of business dealings there. And then, of course, I went to WVU on a football scholarship, and I owned the second biggest nightclub in the state. And I'm really glad we crossed paths. I mean, he's a PR and media strategist and talent manager who's going to tell you what to watch for when picking a firm like this to work with. And we're going to go back and forth a little bit because I've booked all my own media stuff and have never actually paid for this kind of service. So we'll talk about that a little later. Hope you didn't miss episode 403. That was on Instagram. That was one of my Monday in-depth training sessions. And on that episode, I concentrated on some of the relatively new and little known features that will allow you to go to, 50,000 good quality followers. That's if you want to. And thousands of new good quality followers from just one post even. So I give you a lot of the insider secrets there. So how would you like to hear your own voice here on Screw the Commute? Well, if the show has helped you out in your business or given you ideas to help you start a business, we want to hear about it. Visit screwthecommute.com and look for a little blue sidebar that says send a voicemail. Click on it, talk into your phone or computer, and tell me how the show's helped you out. And don't forget, put your website in there so you can get a big shout out on a future episode of Screw the Commute. Now, I got a freebie for you for listening to the show. We sell this book for $27, but it's a book called How to Automate Your Business, and it's how I handled up to 150,000 subscribers and 40,000 customers without pulling my hair out. And it also lets me ethically steal business from a bunch of other schlubs who won't get back to people in a hurry. All right. So this really knocks your workload out and does all kinds of, save me carpal tunnel syndrome. We actually figured it out where just one of the tips in the book saves 7.5 million keystrokes over the years. So grab it at screwthecommute.com/automatefree. screwthecommute.com/automatefree. While you're over there, pick up a copy of our podcast app at screwthecommute.com/app. That's APP, where you can put us on your cell phone and tablet and take us with you on the road. All right, I know people are freaking out with this pandemic still, where you never know what to do. People had to quit their jobs if they even had a job. And the kids are in school one day and not in school the next day. And I don't know, they're telling you the kids will show up to school and burst into flames. I don't know what kind of crap they're trying to shove down your throat. But myself and my students haven't worried about stuff like this because we know how to sell online from home. I've been selling on the commercial internet since there was a commercial internet in 1994 and been teaching this for 23 years and been preaching you need to be able to sell from home and have multiple streams of income and not be dependent on the dreaded J-O-B. And now it's more evident than ever because of what's been going on. I mean, like I said, a lot of parents had to quit their job to watch the kids if they even had a job. So I don't want that for you. And I've been teaching it 23 years, but about 13 years ago, I formalized the training in the form of a school. It's the only licensed, dedicated internet marketing school in the country, probably the world. It's imtcva.org, certified to operate by the State Council on Higher Education in Virginia. But you don't have to be in Virginia. If you can hear this and understand my voice, you can be in this school. It's high-quality distance learning, not like these four-year colleges that are ripping people off, and then all of a sudden they got a distance learning program, two days old. No, we've been doing this for 13 years with very high marks with both the state and our graduates. So a little later, I'll tell you how you can get a full scholarship to the school, which you either use yourself or gift to somebody, and it would be one of the best legacy gifts you could ever give to a young person because the skills that we teach are in super high demand by every business on earth. And just from a selfish point of view, hey, the kids will have their own money and they won't have to come mooch off of you and live in your basement. All right, so we'll talk to you more about that later. All right, let's get to the main event. Burke Allen is the head of Allen Media Strategies. It's a media, marketing, PR, and talent management firm with authors, entertainers, and interesting subject matter experts as clients. He's a veteran broadcaster and on-air talent. He's got that smooth voice that you're going to hear in a minute. He's a former radio station owner and consultant, and he's still a West Virginia boy at heart. Burke, are you ready to screw the commute?
It's always much better to screw than be screwed. That's my opinion. I'm just saying.
I agree with you totally. Well, I'm so glad we crossed paths. I hardly think backwards. I can't even remember how we met, and it wasn't long ago either. That's how bad I am.
I think it was a post office wall, and there may have been livestock involved, but I'm not 100% certain.
Could be, especially us both having roots in West Virginia.
Yee and haw.
Yeah, so, I have written a book called How to Be a Kick Butt Publicity Hound. I had what I considered, and what many people do, some of the best media training on earth with Joel Roberts and Associates. He's now out of Nashville. He was a WABC radio talk show host, which is like the biggest in the big, but he got his ears blown out at a concert and walking in front of the speakers and had to quit his WABC show. So he wasn't too happy about that, but he started teaching media. And so I had his full training. I had Starley Murray's training for television. And I wrote a book on this, being on radio and TV all over the world. And I told you before we started, I used to teach all the way back to Chicken Soup for the Soul as a headliner at all these big events for authors. And we used to tease about companies like yours. So I'm going to give you a chance like that Louder with Crowder show to convince me of how your kind of firm can really help people and who the right kind of person is. We used to tease the one thing that the guy that ran the thing said. He said he used to own one of these firms, and he said, we had a guarantee. We guaranteed we'd send you a bill every month.
And that is the kind of guarantee that you will see out there a lot, especially some of the firms in D.C. that do this.
Oh, my
Believe
goodness.
Me, and that's where I am now.
Yes. Yeah, so I'm all ears, and I'm open the book here to tell us what you do, how you do it, and who's this right for? Because I realize I'm kind of a strange agent. I'm at home all the time and made a lot of money and can do things myself. But I'm sure there's plenty of people out there that don't have the time or expertise to do what you do. So lay it on us. What's it all about?
I love that you are upfront about being a strange agent. Let's just put that out there right now.
People know this anyway, as soon as they meet.
If you have not seen Tom's bio, it's a whole list of strange agent things that have happened to him. He's like the Forrest Gump of Western Pennsylvanians.
They didn't all happen to me. Some of them I instigated myself. I'm really proud
of that.
Yeah,
that is part of that. Yeah, you were not a passive participant in your own demise. So listen, I want to tell you right up front, I believe that you're right. I think anyone can do this themselves. And I believe that wholeheartedly. As a matter of fact, we teach a lot of people to do it themselves. You don't need me, and I don't need any more clients. I've got a 15-year-old son. He's about to turn 16. He's my only one. He's going to go away to college soon. I want to spend as much time with him as I can. As a matter of fact, you may hear him practicing his electric guitar in the background today. So,
oh, good. We have music. Make sure it's not
exactly
copyrighted.
Right. The soundtrack of our lives. Right. Because, he's at home. He's not able to go to school still a year later.
Wow.
He's home with me. But hopefully that will change soon. But I digress. I really do think that you can do this yourself. There are a couple of different things that we do that people sometimes need help with. I've got one client right now who is very sort of meek and timid and shy. And we do a lot of message training with him just so that when he gets interviews, he's able to put his best foot forward or his best mouth forward,
right,
as the case
right.
may be. As a matter of fact, this new client, we've only had him for 2 months, did an interview with WCCO in Minneapolis this morning. And, that's a big deal. That's a top 20 market. That's his hometown market. And so he was over the moon, but we had to get him ready for that. So that's one of the things that we do. And we also do a lot of sort of messaging to make sure that that you've got your I's dotted and your T's crossed. You kind of know what to say whenever you step on that X and the spotlight hits you, because the last thing you want to do is go on some major network, and we put people on all of them, on Fox News and CNN and MSNBC, NBC, ABC, CBS. You don't want to be there, or even, you know, KXXX in Pig Knuckle, Arkansas, and not know what to say or what to do. You got to be ready.
That Pig Knuckle, Arkansas had a 50,000-watt station so that they could reach three cows 20 miles away.
Well, you know, there's some truth to that, Tom, but the other big truth is that in a lot of those smaller tertiary markets, you think of it as a pizza, and the way you slice a pie, there aren't as many stations in those cities. And if you're on the number one or number two station in Lincoln, Nebraska, or Pig Knuckle, Arkansas, you may actually have more listeners, or if it's TV viewers, than you would if you're on the number 30 station in New York or Los Angeles.
Right, exactly.
You know, that's a big lesson that it's hard to get across to the people that live in California or the people that live in New York.
Yeah, I totally agree. But I do agree that there's some things that are a little bit out of my control. Like I was trying to get a message to Hannity. I didn't even want to be on the show. He's a big MMA fan, and I have a website called Brutal Self Defense that I know he would love, but I couldn't get anywhere close to getting him a message, where probably a PR firm probably could.
Yeah. We spend a not inconsequential amount of money every year on databases that get scrubbed constantly. And we keep those up, along with, just because we're in there and in the fight, to use an MMA term all the time.
Right.
Well, you know, we develop relationships, if not with Sean Hannity, and sometimes we do have relationships with the host. More importantly, we develop relationships with the worker bees, the bookers,
producers
on all those shows,
right,
and the producers. And you know what? Let me retract that. Worker bee sounds almost like I'm putting them down. Those are the people that really make the thing run. And if you're nice to those folks, they move around all the time.
Right.
And, you know, I can't tell you how many times, Tom, I met somebody in a small town in West Virginia where, you know, where we both have roots, who moves on and up, and they wind up in New York City or Los Angeles or wherever. It's a very transient industry. So it's good to make friends and build those relationships.
Well, we had one of the biggest ever anchors from West Virginia. We kind of went down in flames, Matt Lauer, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I actually ran into Matt at an event. It was actually a Larry King roast, believe it or not. Larry, R.I.P., rest in peace.
Yeah.
But we talked about him starting out at WOWK-TV there in the Huntington-Charleston market. So, yeah, that's exactly right. And you know, everybody starts somewhere. And, you know, when you get a little bit more mileage on you, like I have, you kind of grow up in the industry with these people. And when I was a radio talent and TV talent, I met and worked with a lot of those people when we were all starting. So now it's a lot easier to pick up the phone or shoot an email or a text to somebody and get an answer. So, you know, those are some of the reasons and to work with a firm. And I guess the one other big reason is it's always a time value proposition, right? So if I can get something done in 10 minutes and it would take you 10 hours,
right,
then it obviously makes more sense for you to pay me to do it than for you to go and try to reinvent the wheel. But none of it's brain surgery. I don't do anything that's super complicated. It's just a lot of nose to the grindstone work. We gut it out and we work hard every day.
Yeah. And relationships, like you said, like the relationships that somebody off the street would never have and could never even get to those, even the producers or anybody.
Relationships really are our currency. You're exactly right.
So what's the right type of person that should use your service, and what's the type of person that maybe shouldn't?
So we get way more submissions than we accept. And that's, again, for people to pay us a monthly retainer, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you've got to be, the two big things are unique and compelling. And so if you have a unique point of view on whatever the news story is that's out there, for example, I've got an author right now who's a researcher on COVID-19, but he takes the contrarian view. He's a guy who from the beginning says, you know, lockdowns are not going to help. He had done his research. He had the numbers to point it out. And so he zigs while everybody else zags. So he's unique in that way.
Yeah, but do they even let him on nowadays?
They do, and there are two ways to do it. Of course, you put them on conservative media that makes sense.
Okay.
And then we also put them on as a point-counterpoint guy, because boring broadcasting on TV, radio, podcast, anything, is when everybody syncs up and you're all sort of swimming in the right place. So, you know, we put them on and say, hey, look, debate this guy. He's got the numbers to prove it. So that's the unique piece. If you got something unique to say, and it doesn't necessarily have to be a current topical news story, it can be anything that's different, that makes you a little different. I'll give you one other example. One of my clients that I've had for years, and we're going to keep talking about my beloved home state of West Virginia.
Right.
One of my guys is the season 6 winner of America's Got Talent. His name's Landau Eugene Murphy Jr.
And oh, yeah. I remember that vividly. He sounds like Frank Sinatra.
That's exactly right. He sings that stuff incredibly, but if you open your eyes, you see not only does he sing Sinatra great, he's a tall, skinny, black guy with dreadlocks.
Right, exactly. I remember the episode when he did his audition vividly.
And, you know, we've been able, Tom, to maintain a career for him for 10 years. It's been 10 years since he won that show, and he still performs all over the country, all over the world, because he has a unique thing. You don't expect that voice to come out of that guy. So you got to be kind of unique. So that's the first part. The compelling piece is a little bit easier, and that is, you know, look, if you're the only one-armed banjo picker back there in Pignuckle, Arkansas, well, that's unique. It's not necessarily compelling, right? So it has to be a broad enough tent that people are going to care. And we do get an awful lot of authors, for example, that send us a book, and it's really more for friends and family, right? It's not anything the rest of the world is going to care about. So unique and compelling. You got those two things, you got a shot.
Well, we may have to ask Pignuckle, Arkansas Chamber of Commerce for some sponsorship money for this episode.
I'm all in for sponsorships.
Yeah. and one of the things you were saying earlier, if everybody just agrees, it's not much of a show. But I remember being taught that the media likes heat, not light. So they'd rather have you fighting about something than actually learning about something.
Yeah, that is one of those sad kind of commentaries on the world. And it's ramped up way more. But it's the old you slow down to look at a car accident kind of thing.
Right.
You know, when Bill O'Reilly was on Fox for years and years, and I've actually seen the research, you know, in my broadcast career, we did a ton of audience research. I've seen the research, and you know, he would scream and yell, Tom, and pound on the desk, and that would get people to stop when they're clicking through the channels, right?
I know.
Why are the veins on that guy's head popping out, and why is he turning red? Let's stop and see. So that's absolutely true. That's also, by the way, why you see those incredible graphics on Fox News Channel and CNN, where things fly and whiz in all the time, breaking news and all that. It's the Star Wars effect. It causes people to stop. So it's way more about giving good show and being entertaining and energetic, many of the same things that a great speaker does, than the content itself. Sad to say.
Yeah, and I can see, on Fox they say, breaking news alert, and then it's 2:00, you know. Something so it gets kind of old when you sit here and watch TV.
Breaking
all
news
day.
Alert, I have a new time.
Yeah. So one thing I really was impressed with your background in history, because I want to take you back, and we'll go through your entrepreneurial journey here for everybody, but you had, I mean, the story about your mother and father was just so compelling to me. Your mother was a polio person, and I don't want to say victim, because she was about as far from a victim as I can ever think of anybody. But, you know, when she went to work in a wheelchair in 4 inches of snow and the police officer was trying to call off, I just loved that.
Yeah, she was amazing. So
take
both
us back
parents.
A little bit. Tell us how you came up.
Well, you're very kind to say that, and thank you very much. Both my folks have passed now, but so my dad was let me back up before that. I grew up in the coal fields of southern West Virginia, so about as deep into Appalachia as you can imagine, a real hard scrabble, blue-collar town. And my parents were both in wheelchairs. My dad was a disabled vet, and if you can imagine, he was a guy who served in World War II in Korea, was a Golden Gloves boxer, and wound up being in the VA hospital for 4 years after spinal cord surgery, never walked again, had to retrain himself on a new way to make a living, because he was a machinist in the Navy and he would most certainly have been a miner. And so while he was flat on his back in the VA hospital, he went back, got his high school diploma, because he joined the Navy, by the way, when he was 16. It was World War II. And, you know, his parents signed off on that, got his high school diploma, got his college acceptance, and then took a correspondence course in the hospital there, in the VA hospital in Cleveland, to learn how to be a watch and clock repairman. And so that's what he did. It's something he could do sitting down.
Wow.
And he had a monocle and a watch bench with thousands of little gears, and repaired all the watches and clocks in my little hometown the whole time I was growing up. My mom was a childhood polio survivor. She caught it when she was 5.5 months old.
Mm.
It was, ripping through America in the 1930s, and it stopped at her house, and they didn't know what to do back then. So she had a dozen surgeries by the time she was 12, and they each one made it successively worse, because she was actually up on walking on braces when she was a little girl. I've got a few pictures, but eventually she was bound to a wheelchair. But amazingly, she was the first handicapped student to graduate from public high school in the state of West Virginia in 1952.
Wow.
Went on to college, went to West Virginia State.
And this wasn't normal at the time, right?
I don't think most women graduated from college in 1952, much less, from a sitting down position. Left home, left and went hours away to Charleston to go to college. Got her degree, wound up being the city police clerk in our hometown, Logan, for the next 30 years.
Wow.
So that meant she typed every warrant that came out of that little town, because none of the policemen could type, did all the parking tickets, all the reports. And indeed, there was one morning, and I heard the story at her funeral. They went back and they flew all the flags at half mast in our little town. The police chief at the time came up to me and he said, I was a little junior patrolman one day, and it came about 4 or 5 inches of snow. And at 8:25, your mother was due here at 8:30. I see the car come in. I see her single-handedly get her wheelchair out of the back seat of the car.
Oh my God.
She then grabs a broom, swipes all the snow off of it, hoists herself into the wheelchair, makes it through the snow, up the ramp into the police station. And the phone rings at 8:30, and it's one of the patrolmen calling to say, there's snow out there. I don't think I can make it in. And, and the police chief ripped into him immediately. You get your ass in here right now. Pat Adkins in a wheelchair can come in. And so that's the way I grew up.
Yeah.
But Tom, I didn't know any different. I was 6 years old before I knew anybody's parents were up on their feet, because they never made a deal out of it. It was just their thing.
Oh, what an amazing, amazing upbringing. And then, what was your path then after that? Did you go to school, college?
Yeah.
Did you have any jobs? What happened?
Well, interestingly enough, as part of my mom's job at the police department, she used the police radio. And in Southern West Virginia in the 1970s, there were some pretty thick accents. So it was the Logan City Police Department, and we had a scanner at home. So my dad and I could hear her on the radio, and I can still hear in my mind's eye, I can hear her say, LCPD to Unit 2, we have a public service. And that's her asking the policeman to pull over to payphone. There were no cells to call into the station. So I was fascinated with broadcasting, and part of her job, there were only two radio stations and one newspaper in that town. And they would all call her a couple of times a day to see if there was any breaking news in our town of 3,500 people. And so I was fascinated by that whole thing. She was so close to the communication. So when I was 14 years old, she asked the news director at one of the radio stations if I could come up and shadow him. And at 14, I had my first job on the radio at WLOG in Logan, West Virginia.
Wow.
Became the editor of my high school newspaper, so I could learn how to write there, and took that on to Marshall University, where I spent a cup of coffee in school and mostly worked at the radio station there in Huntington, and then off to the races.
Did you get hired at a station again? You own some stations, right?
Yeah, so when I went to Huntington, I still remember talking to the head of the journalism school there, a great lady named Dottie Johnson, and I said, Mrs. Johnson, do you think I could ever, in my wildest dreams, break into the Huntington, West Virginia market? Because that was so far away from anything a Coalfields kid could imagine. But yeah, I worked at the Big Top 40 station there, and then in Charleston, and in West Virginia, once you worked in Huntington and Charleston and maybe Morgantown, that's as far as you can go. So after that, I started getting a lot of moving stickers on my furniture. I was in Savannah and Salt Lake City, Las Vegas, Orlando, and became a broadcast consultant here in D.C. about 25
years ago.
Okay,
but all those different places, you were on air?
I was on air and eventually worked my way into programming.
What
I
was it, talk or music?
Did them all.
What?
Did them all. Did as a young guy, did top 40 radio. So I was, you know, the hot rockin' flamethrowing nighttime DJ on your top 40 station.
what year was this?
Oh, 1985 to 1993.
What were you playing at the time?
Oh, we played everything. You know, we had all the big boy bands from New Kids on the Block and New Edition to Milli Vanilli, who didn't really sing right. their songs, you know, and all points in between. So we did all of that. And as I got older, I worked at stations that targeted an older audience, always enjoyed the music part of it very much. And then as consolidation happened in radio 1996, began to manage stations and including talk stations. Eventually, consulted radio stations, bought a couple back home in West Virginia so I could write off my trips to go home and see mom.
Wow.
and you know, loved every bit of it. Did some TV. That was 20 years and 40 pounds ago when I was a little, you know, because the TV puts on pounds.
Yes, and, of course, yeah.
Yeah. And so do I.
Well, yeah, they say it puts on 10 pounds. And I said, well, how many cameras have been watching me at 10 pounds
each?
Yeah,
that's exactly right. Exactly right. Can we not use the fisheye lens when I'm right. on TV? And did a little bit of all of it. And it was a blast. I loved being on the air. I loved the programming. And when you program radio stations, that's where I really learned how to teach people how to do interviews. Because I saw so many interviewees do it right. really badly. You and I are close to the same age. I remember there was a band that was popular in the 70s and 80s from Germany called the Scorpions.
Yep.
And they were a rock band, heavy rock band. They came into the radio station where I was doing afternoons, and the record company guy wanted me to interview the Scorpions, who didn't speak a lick of English. It was the worst. It was painful radio for 20 minutes. They were German. And so, you know, you learn what to do and what not to do. And when you put the shoe on the other foot, now I can help people. So when they get their 3 minutes, and that's about what it is, by the way, if right. you're on Good Morning America, the Today Show, you got just 3 or 4 minutes to make sure you hit all your talking points and you drive people to your website. You know, you figure out a way to collect those email addresses and begin. That's the beginning of the relationship.
So can you think of any other big disasters while you're live on air?
Besides this program, there have been no other big disasters.
Yeah, right.
No, I actually can. And it's funny, there have been so many, we could do an entire show about the disasters on the air. But I was set up once in front of the Charleston Civic Center Coliseum to do my afternoon show live, and it was another rock show.
This
it
is
was
a Kiss remote and, or something?
Yeah, that's yeah, yeah. Moment. They had a big, huge, they called it the Big Red Roving Radio. It looked like a big boombox. And you broadcast live in front. And Kiss was the headliner. And there was a band named L.A. Guns that was opening up. And they were these sort of bad boys. They were part of the guys that used to be in Guns N' Roses. So anyway, yeah, yeah. They come out, and this is live on the air. And the guy says, and you'll have to forgive me for this, and your sensitive listeners, but he says, oh, so it's so great to be here. And where the f- am I? Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to say f- on the radio.
Oh,
and I just said, oh, and there goes the FCC license.
Right.
It's gone. So, yes, there have been many, many instances of hijinks on the air. And somehow I'm still alive to tell the tale.
There you go. So when was the transition to the Allen Media Strategies?
Well, so radio is a tough taskmaster, and so is television. Broadcasting, you know, by its very nature, you move up and down around the dial, like they say on WKRP. And I really did have, I'm not kidding you, Tom, a different city every 18 months for 10 years.
Wow.
I worked for a company called CBS Broadcasting, and they would have me come in and fix their radio stations. And I had all these moving stickers on my furniture, and you know, you never put down roots, and I was in cool cities at least. You know, I was in Las Vegas, and I loved the outdoors, so I loved to ski in Salt Lake City and do the outdoor stuff. And of course, Orlando, I get to ride the roller coasters for free. But you never really feel like you're at home. So when I had the opportunity to come back to DC, it put me within driving distance of West Virginia. My mom was older; I'm right. the only child. That was important to me. And I became a broadcast consultant and then hung the shingle out here. And the way it all began was there was a psychologist in Pittsburgh, actually, close to where you grew up. Mm-hmm. And she had a great concept, but she had stage fright. and she was afraid to not only do public speaking, but afraid to do media interviews. And I brought her in and helped her get past that. And we developed her messaging, and she wound up doing, I think, 63 interviews in the first month and was off to the races. And then, you know, it was like the old Degree shampoo commercial. One led to the next and led to the next. And here we are.
Wow. 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 So we got to take a brief sponsor break. When we come back, we'll ask Burke what's a typical day look like for him and maybe what changes have happened since COVID's hit with the media business. And I know the only upside that I can think of, and I don't want to downplay the pain and misery, but I hate going to New York for interviews. I never felt so helpless in my whole life going to New York City, because you go up there and the cab drivers know you're a tourist, so they mess with you. And then you're afraid to get on the subway because you never know where you'll end up. And then people will say, well, yeah, you just walk to your hotel. And it's like 100 blocks. Each block is bigger than my hometown.
That's right.
So I avoid the interviews up there. But anyway, we'll be back with Burke in a second to see what typical day looks like for him. So folks, about 23 years ago, I kind of turned the internet marketing guru world on its head, and the people at my level were charging 50 or 100 grand up front to teach this stuff to small business people. And I knew a lot of these people. You give them 50 grand up front, they'd be hiding out in a deep mine in West Virginia, so they wouldn't have to help you. So I said, that's not right. I'm going to fix this. So I started charging an entry fee, which was way lower. And then for me to get my 50,000, you had to make 200,000 net. And people loved this because they knew I wouldn't disappear on them. And 1,700 students, and yeah, more than that now, and 23 years later, it's still going strong. It's the longest running, most unique, most successful mentor program in the field of internet marketing ever. Number one, we only pay an entry fee. You don't pay the big money. I'm tied to your success. That's number two. Number three is that everything is one-on-one. We don't like group coaching around here, because if I'm talking to the advanced people, the beginners are lost. And if I'm talking to the beginners, the advanced people are bored. So everything is one-on-one with me and my entire staff. We'll take over your computer, show you where to click, what to do. We give you strategy. If you have no business, that's fine. If you already have a business you want to take to the next level, we talk to you at whatever level you're at, so you're not lumped in with a bunch of other folks. And you get a scholarship to the school I talked about earlier that you can either use yourself for extra training or gift it to someone. And I'll tell you what, I'm really upset about these four-year colleges, and I'm a big proponent of education, but the way things are going now, kids are getting in deep debt. They're just learning how to protest, and then they're taking their MBA and competing for jobs at Starbucks. So that's not the way it works around here. We have people making money after a couple months in the school. We have one girl, 4 months into the school, she's up to $6,000 a month as a side hustle, because every business on earth needs these skills. And when I say skills, I'm talking about email marketing and chat bots and text marketing and blogs and shopping carts and social media. All that stuff is in the school. And it's, like I said, it's the only one of its kind in the country, probably the world. So anyway, check out my mentor program at greatinternetmarketingtraining.com, greatinternetmarketingtraining.com. Give me a call. I'm very accessible, and no high pressure around here, but we'll discuss your future online, and anybody in your family or young people in your life, grandchildren, nephews, nieces, how we can help them too. All right, let's get back to the main event. We're here with Burke Allen from Allen Media Strategies, and he has convinced me that there's certain people that should be using his kind of service, and certainly some people that need to do a little bit of homework before they try to go to the big time with Burke. So, Burke, tell us what a typical day looks like for you, and has it changed since the COVID thing hit and all that?
Well, I sleep till noon, and then I roll out, and some days I shower, some days, no. It's, so it has changed a lot. I have offices, small office suite, right outside Washington, D.C., in Reston, Virginia, and for folks that come around here and used to live in this area, you know, we're right by Dulles Airport, and I did that on purpose because, frankly, Tom, I knew before moving here that I was going to screw the commute.
Right.
And I did not win the Beltway ever, unless it's lunchtime. I never want to deal with that. Some of the worst traffic in the country is here.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I lived on the other side of town and in Maryland, on the Maryland side, and I would fly out of Baltimore so I wouldn't have to go in the Beltway.
You know exactly what I'm talking about. So I chose not to get involved in all of that traffic, and I can be at, you know, the airport in, you know, less than 10 minutes. Well, of course, during COVID, I've been to the airport exactly one time in the last year.
You got me beat. A year and a half, I haven't been on a plane. So
yeah, which is real weird, right? So,
but I'm happy about it. I'm not, you know, I wasn't thrilled about all the travel to start with.
I'm lucky. I get to go normally to really nice places. I'm lamenting a little bit that there is no Florida nor California sunshine in my winter this year.
Yeah.
Having said that, I have found that I'm very, very productive, and I'm doing a lot of work from home. I maintain the office. I run in there and grab the mail once a week in the office suite. But everybody on my little team is working from home right now. We've all got kids who are homeschooled because of COVID, and when that eases up, we'll head back into the office. But it's a whole lot of being on the phone for me, Tom. I'm like a teenage girl, you know, because it's a lot of calling producers and maintaining friendships and relationships and actually helping people get on the air. Every day, our company has somebody on a show somewhere, whether they're on TV, on a podcast, on the radio, doing a newspaper interview. So there's at least one and usually multiple ones of those every day. So I'm kind of like an air traffic controller, just sort of maintaining all of that. And I do it, you know, at different times. I've learned little tips on how to stack things. You know, if I'm in line at the grocery store, it's amazing how much you can get out and done while you're standing there. And and so, yeah, that's what I do. But it's very similar to what you teach in that with this job, you can do a lot of it from anywhere. And I'll give you a great example. And maybe some of your listeners may want to think about this if they have kids at home. My son, as I told you, is almost 16, and I know I've only got a limited amount of time with him. So a couple of months ago, he and I loaded our laptops up, and we went on a road trip down to Tennessee and North Carolina, and we spent 10 days in a couple of log cabins out in the woods. And he did his online school from there, and I did my work from there. And when we were finished, we were able to enjoy the outdoors and stay safe and stay socially distanced, but not let it completely impact our lives. You know, we stocked up with groceries and went and did. So I am all in for anybody that can unshackle themselves from the corporate world. You know, if I were still in broadcasting, Tom, working for those big companies, they have all had massive layoffs,
right?
You know, with COVID and automation combined, you know, I might be on the beach right now. I might be totally out of work. So I'm glad I worked for myself for the last 20 years.
Well, I'll tell you what, there's a bunch of people that need you, because I've watched these national shows and people that should know better just look like hell. Sound like hell. You're seeing their ceiling because their laptops like shooting up their nostrils. It's just
all of that
on national TV. But the bar is lowered. People say, oh, well, we want to get so-and-so on the show, whatever. If they can get any kind of signal at all, they throw them up there.
You know, I'm glad you mentioned that, though, because that is the great equalizer that has come along in the last year. You talked about how much you used to hate to go to New York. And that is kind of a pain. Like, I've done media tours with clients up there where we have to run around from studio to studio and do one right after the other. And you know, look, I'm not going to lie. There's a little bit of adrenaline. And when you walk under the set of Fox and Friends or the Today Show or whatever, that is kind of cool. But now, no matter where you are in the country, you could have a book, and if it's unique and compelling, and you could live in Broken Balls, Montana, right? And you could zoom right in from Broken Balls, Montana, and be on any of those shows, and they would never have done that a year ago. And one of the deep, dark secrets to network television shows and cable news is that almost all of their guests prior to this were in Washington, D.C. or New York City, because they could get guests in, they had some control over the situation. They knew there was, you know, a bunch of people in those cities. But what it eliminated, Tom, were varying points of view from all the real hardworking people in Middle America. You could never get on the air from Kansas City or St. Louis.
Is there Middle America? You wouldn't know it by watching live. lot of stations.
That's exactly right. And having said that, much better now with Zoom because people can get in from anywhere. But man, it was bad for a long time. So I see that as a real opportunity, and we've done that a whole bunch. You know, I've got a client who's a war hero, former Navy SEAL, and he does TV from his place down in right outside Pensacola all the time.
Yeah.
So you can be anywhere.
Yeah. It's, it has opened things up. But like I said, a lot of them, you know, need some training to look their best on these things.
And know how to do it. You know, what is with the staring up the nostril?
Right.
Or, you know, the attorney that couldn't turn off his cat video.
Oh, that was great. And, well, the other attorney, Jeffrey Toobin.
yeah, and thank God his camera was turned on.
You don't train that, do you?
And that's a whole different kind of screw in the community.
Right. Oh, man.
So you got to know what to do and what not to do. And it's all, you know, you're an old football guy. It's all blocking and tackling, right? And stuff you can learn. Anybody can do
Well, you know, that Nobody's whole school board just had to resign because they were ragging on all the parents before a meeting, and it was going out to the parents.
Yep.
And they all of them resigned. I saw it yesterday in the news because they messed up.
Yeah, you got to think it through. And again, none of it is brain surgery. Anyone can do it. You don't need me. Frankly, you don't even need Tom. You can do it, but you got to get somebody to point you in the right direction.
Yeah, you That's need to have thing. Some real critique of your skills. And I mean, I remember Starley Murray, I was, you know, was booking me on TV. And she said, well, we got to shoot some pictures of you from the side. And I said, well, why? Well, she said, that's what the camera is going to see from the side. It is not, you're not looking into the camera. You're not reading a teleprompter. You're being interviewed.
Right.
And
that's
so
right.
That's one of the tips I learned from her about, you know, your it's not so much for me because I have short hair, but a lot of women, you know, their hair is going to come down and hide their eyes from certain angles, you know. So it's good to have a third party, and I'm sure your people do all that stuff. But did you?
Yeah, we teach people how to dress, you know, and you know, if you're a lady, not to wear big dangly earrings that will distract from what you're saying, or if you're a guy, not to wear plaids. Yeah, I mean, there's all these just little tips that you need to know before you get in there.
Yeah, and I still see some of this day the thing called the moiré effect, where somebody that knows should know better has got a tie that just looks like it's Christmas time. It's sparkling all over the place. So yeah, there's lots of tips and tricks. Now, prior to this COVID, were you meeting with people in person to teach them this stuff, or just remotely?
Yeah, we would have them come into DC and do media training workshops. We would actually teach them in studios, you know, so you could replicate exactly what it's like with the camera and the lights.
Did you have a studio, or a radio studio, rented them, or what?
We would do both, right? So there was a great broadcast school facility, and I taught at that broadcast school, and it would take that over. And then we would also walk them through real broadcast facilities. Like, as you remember from being here in DC, WTOP, we would do walkthroughs.
I was on there.
The big news station, or Fox News, or the local CNN bureau. And so they could see what it's really like. You know, the more you can replicate what it's really going to be like whenever you get there, the easier it's going to be for you. And then you don't freak out. It's okay to be a little nervous, but you don't want to have a meltdown in the middle of your interview, because that's your time to shine.
Yeah. And it reminds me of, I did a lot in San Antonio and about being nice to everybody, but the, you know, not just the host. So there's a stage manager in San Antonio that would do anything I wanted. I acknowledged how hardworking she was. I brought her donuts, and like, she was just, nobody ever gave her any kind. The people that worked there never gave her any kind of accolades, but she was the one running the whole show pretty much. I mean, she was just amazing. And so, be nice to everybody around there. They're the hard workers that are making the big shot arrogant anchors all look good, you know. So
that's a great tip. And you know, those big shot arrogant anchors lots of times have zero input on what is actually covered on the air.
Yeah,
if you want to get on your local TV station, for example, to talk about whatever it is you want to talk about, going to the anchor or the reporter will get you zero help. You got to go to the assignment editor, and the assignment editor assigns what's actually going to go on the show. So you're totally kissing the wrong butt there. And look, I also believe, frankly, And I think you do too. I think you and I have a lot in common. The golden rule, be nice to everybody.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, be nice to the waiter when they come around. That's one of my big judges is if I want to work with somebody. Back in the day when we could actually have lunch with people, if they really pursued me and they wanted us to represent them, I would always take them to lunch and just watch their interaction with the server. If they were kind to the server, they made eye contact with the server, they're probably going to be okay. But boy, those people that were crappy with the server, I would never, ever take them on as a client.
I get it. And I every time I'm in front of a cashier or something, I make them laugh. I have fun with them. Like no matter what I'm buying, and the weirder the better, I ask for the extended warranty. So,
oh, yeah.
So if I'm good at McDonald's, I say, I'll take extended warranty. And they think about it and then they laugh. And I tell them at the bank they should have a tip jar. You know, the service is so wonderful. You can't go in that anymore. So I just have fun with people. And that's, you know, like I said, both of us came from small towns, although you're kind of a big metropolis guy compared to my hometown. Your town is 7 times bigger than my hometown.
Wow. Yeah, we did have a couple of stoplights at least, Tom.
No, we had a 4-way stop, but only 2 of the ways went anywhere. Now, how do they get a hold of you? Didn't you have something to give the folks?
I'm running from the law, and I never divulge that information. I do. You know, Tom is much larger than me, and he did hurt people on the football field. So when he asked if I would give something away, immediately, of course, I said yes, in deference to my own health and well-being. In all seriousness, what I want to give away, I think, would be really good for at least a portion of your listeners. So if somebody is an author or a subject matter leader or whatever, and they need some free publicity, when COVID hit, Tom, I taught a 4-week course on how to do it yourself. Because as I said, you really don't need me. And I videotaped all that. It was done on Zoom and recorded those sessions. And it was two a week. On Monday nights, we taught them the concept of how to do something. And on Wednesday nights, they played their homework back, and I would critique their performance,
wow.
Critique, you know, how they wrote their press release or how they did their interview, and we actually interviewed them and critiqued that. I've got all of that saved, and I'll give it away to the first 10 people that shoot an email and just put screw the commute in the subject line. Screw the commute in the subject
okay.
line. Email me at info@allenmediastrategies.com, and that'll come right to me, info@allenmediastrategies.com. And I'll send these out to you. It's my gift, and you can just thank the Screw the Commute folks for making it happen.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. So, oh man, it's great catching up with you, hearing this inspiring story of your upbringing, parents, and the insight into the media world. I just got a good feel for how smart you are by, you know, living outside the Beltway. So you don't have to go to the Beltway.
That's exactly right. No matter how cold it is in the wintertime, there's always plenty of hot air filtering out from downtown D.C.
There you go. All right. So thanks so much, Burke, for coming on. And make sure everybody, first 10 of you, info@AllenMediaStrategies, get this fantastical media training for no cost whatsoever. If you do want some media training, give Burke a call. It's AllenMediaStrategies.com, and see if there's a fit there for you. But I really like this guy because he's a down home country boy and came from really good roots that taught him a lot of good stuff as a young man. So that's the kind of people we like here. So
thank you, Tom. I appreciate you having me on, and screw the commute.
All right.